Imagine this challenge, a journey never before recorded in aviation history. You crossed the Atlantic in Hoover, Africa, by way of a small, twin-propelled airplane. The journey was spanned across three continents, 24 countries, and 47 cities. A 68-day journey consisting roughly of 115 hours of flight time and an awe-inspiring distance of 21,700 miles. The airplane would have to be modified with air tanks for fuel reserves and electronic devices to simplify the Hoover primitive content. Over 20 visas and careful planning is required to get through customs from rival countries. This is the story of two men who dared this challenge.
Jack on the right, myself on the left, in the hangar at Sky Harbor, Northbrook, Illinois, on morning of January 10th, 1973. The plane with which we're about to cross the Atlantic and tour Africa, on the left are housekeepers, Ellen and Toivo Kars, who accompanied my wife and myself, my youngest son, Peter, to the airport that morning. Here we are getting ready for the momentous trip. During the trip, we had to fly to Detroit to check through American customs and record the fact that Jack wanted to sell the plane while we were overseas. We then flew on to Montreal, spent the evening, and the next morning flew to Gander, Newfoundland. Here we are coming into Gander, which is a very cold, desolate area. From there, we took off, flew from Gander to Santa Maria in the Azores, spent the night, took off the next day, and landed in Lisbon. We had no pictures of the flight across the Atlantic because we left at night and flew during the daytime, and it was nighttime by the time we landed again. This is from the Ritz Hotel in Lisbon. Here's Jack in the hotel room getting his camera equipment ready with a drink on the side. Notice how formally we were dressed, and we stayed that way for a few days. Very rainy, blustery day in Lisbon. Lisbon's a lovely city. This is one of the beautiful palaces in the area. And then from Lisbon, we were instructed by the State Department under no circumstances fly into Africa from Portugal. They wanted us to come in from Spain. So we had to fly from Lisbon to Seville, check through customs, and then take off to Africa. The Portuguese had for 500 years maintained colonies, which were under much pressure in those days. Well, here we are at the airport in Seville, checking through the regulators to fly on to Tangier. Landing at Tangier, starting the African adventure. This is the Atlantic coast. Morocco, of course, faces both the Mediterranean and the Atlantic. A lovely palace. No matter how luxurious a building may be on the inside, the exterior is always very plain, simple, unproposing. Whether it's an important mosque or a palace, you could never tell from the exterior. Once you go through the entrance, you're met by unbelievable charm and lovely fountains and architecture. This is the dead of winter over there, a little warmer than our latitude, but not much. There's a street scene in downtown Tangier. You can see the tobacco shop on the left. French is spoken by most people, although a great number also speak Spanish. The French and the Spanish armies overran this area in the early part of the last century. particularly like the picture of the young woman on the right with a plastic blue bag and her face covered so only her eyes are showing. True Muslim and a very young, pretty girl. It's kind of hard to believe we're only 20 miles from Europe. All the shops seem to be open-aired. They're not shops as we would consider them. They're not indoors. They're stalls. Another pretty young lady, jewelry outside of her caftan, voguish sunglasses, face fairly well covered. Jack buying some nuts or dates. Very, very colorful. Just see all the varieties of herbs and fruits for sale in these open-air stalls. I'm on my way into the bank to get some local currency. See, I'm wearing a fedora and a raincoat. The outside the city, and you can see the tower of a religious building in the foreground. Minarets of several mosques in the background. This very typical square minaret. There's some more street scenes, lots of flowers, and they sell quite well there, and an open-air butcher shop, which apparently has reasonable sanitation, although it wouldn't interest many Westerners. There are a couple of calves' heads if you so want them. God knows what the other parts are. Shelves packed up 20 feet in the air, which they use long ladders to get to. Definitely not on the supermarket style of American shopping. You stand in front and tell the clerk what you want. Russian plane bringing pilgrims back from Mecca. A lot of Soviet presence in North Africa at the airports. I believe this is an Aeroflot. While Jack and I were at a restaurant the night before, we met three Frenchmen, two young ladies and a young man who were school teachers. Jack flew two of them on to Fez the next morning, and I went by road with one of the young ladies in a car. Here we are coming into a town called Meknes. This is one of the great gates to the city of Meknes. Very confusing going through these towns. Besides Tangier, there's Meknes, which one has to go through to reach Fez. These early cities were heavily fortified. There must have been a hell of a lot of fighting going on in the 10th or 12th century when these were built. And here we are with a water seller, a fellow who's got a colorful bag, probably made out of goatskin with 50 bangles on it to draw attention. Carries a little silver cups around with him, which you can buy a drink of water. Now we're in Fez on the inside of a beautiful mosque. It's in a religious school. The tile work is the most exquisite I've ever seen. We have nothing in the West to compare to it. The Muslims are not allowed to portray humans, and so they developed a style of architecture quite unique and heavily based on mathematical designs. This is a tomb of a sultan. It's a mausoleum, I guess you'd call it. There are two or three wives' tombs out there in front. I suppose placement might indicate their rank. Muslims are allowed to have four wives and apparently an unlimited number of concubines, because you would see a number of graves of concubines at these locations. It's a 1,000-year-old bridge. Looks like it was built last month. This is one of the battlements in the outer walls of Fez. Magnificent city with several hundred thousand living in this, what amounts to a giant shopping center. They live, they work, they're born, they die there. Very much a medieval town. The people from the 14th or 15th century would feel quite at home. Beautiful castle up on a hill. We stayed at the best hotel in town. This is the view from my room in the Palace Jamez, which overlooks the city. And you can see in the background the minarets of several mosques. When the dawn arrives in the morning, besides hearing all the proud roosters calling to wake you up, you start hearing the mullahs chanting one after another. And apparently there's an important pecking order. The most important mosque starts calling first, then the others, and it's like a musical canon. one overlaid the other. Quite beautiful, quite interesting, very different than any Westerner has ever seen or heard. Here's a typical transportation. Got some people riding on donkeys, others climbing on the roof of the bus. It's the smallest taxi I've ever been in my life. The petite taxi, I've taken it a couple of times, and boy, is it small. Petite is the correct word. In the heart of Fez, this street scene, a couple of fellas with a load of beautiful Moroccan goat hides that will ultimately end up in someone's library in Europe. The odoriferous place where hides get treated, the hair is removed, is bathed in a number of baths before it gets dyed. One end of this tannery, the odor is incredibly awful. The hides are then put in pigeon guano, which is pretty stinky, and which one guy just stomps on them for hours, working the pigeon manure into the hides. But ultimately, they get down to the dyeing vats. And here's one of the most colorful scenes in the world. Vats that have probably had dye in them for 500 years without ever being cleaned. All these seem to be red. And this becomes beautiful Moroccan leather that usually goes into bookbinding. They use natural chemicals, probably from the acacia Niger. And this is sometimes called Niger. It's very different than our Western tanning, which uses chromium and other metallic chemicals, which leave brittle leather. This leather is very, very subtle. Probably the best there is. Here I am on top of the roofs in the area, taking pictures down on the vats. You can see in the background leather drying on the roofs across the way. On the right, you can see hides drying on straw on the roof. Here's hair from the goats being swept up. What they do with it, I do not know. Red hides, it looks like wool down below. But there are hides drying in every direction. Yellow hides, almost lost in the straw. Here we are back at the theological school. Most beautiful tile roofs one can imagine. Blue-green in color, and if you could take out the telephone lines in the background, this would look like it had looked 1,000 years earlier. Minaret from a mosque, taken through some beautiful ornate ironwork. Much of Fez is being restored. It's been declared by UNESCO as a World Historic Place, and they've been given several $100 million to restore some of the beautiful carvings, architectural work, and tiles. And there are artisans all over town working on this. Another gate to an important building. We are back in an alleyway. Because there's an awful lot of sun coming down, they have lattice type shades they can pull across. This is wool that's been dyed and is being dried for sale. It's a typical street scene with a lady with a little girl in her arm and another child below going through town. An old timer on the left with a typical outfit. Little girl carrying her sister on the right. There's an old timer relaxing out in front of a door. Beautifully colorful kaftan with a typical modest scarf in front of her face. A really old timer with a nice warm heavy woolen kaftan. A couple of fellas having a smoke on the street. A lighting store with lighting fixtures and candles. Very, very colorful. Clearly an executive walking with a gabardine coat and briefcase. A card game. Looked down this courtyard and I saw these fellows playing cards and couldn't resist taking the picture. Now we're seeing transportation. Here's firewood moving about the town on the only mode of transportation that can operate here. The streets are so narrow, there are no trucks or cars, but burros. Here's another one with, it looks like, a load of tambourines on it. Even white goods moving through the streets on the back of a burro. Fellow riding a burro. More packages being delivered. This is the UPS of the area. And even garbage being removed by these small donkeys. Burro with a light load going by a shop. Looks like he's carrying cork. More candles. I think this is what ladies would call bobbins of silk, thread, every color imaginable. Picture taken through a doorway. This is a courtyard in a mosque. The men and women apparently come in at different times in these mosques. You don't see them together. A bunch of stalls that will probably be open in a little while, or may have just closed. Here is some ornate bronze work on an ancient door. The work is beautiful beyond belief, and behind it you can see some lovely tile work. But much of this has been destroyed over the years, and is going to have to be rebuilt. Here's a gate to the town. Another view of the town wall. The town walls have a considerable number of fist-sized holes in them, where apparently they allow swallows to nest and hold down the bug population. This is another view of the town from outside the walls. We flew from Fez to Marrakesh, the city that Winston Churchill referred to as the Paris of the desert. Looks beautiful from the air. Marrakesh is between the ocean and the Atlas Mountains. Beautiful location. You can go skiing in winter there. Here we are coming down to land. That's the International Terminal. Water cellars. Even more colorful than what I pictured at Fez. And they love to have their picture taken, and you're supposed to tip them. Grain depot in the open, in the heart of town. Looks like some soldiers who probably are buyers for the military, looking through the quality of grain they're about to buy. Lots of it around. Here is another mausoleum, and in the courtyard to the right you can see the graves of some of the concubines of the Sultan. Lovely entrance to the mausoleum. And this is a dungeon down below. There are pits you can see on the left with the cover removed. They apparently threw prisoners. Very touristy city. Gets quite a few English tourists. Lovely landscaping and foliage. This museum of local artifacts, which are just absolutely gorgeous. I've always been partial to Moroccan rugs, and they also have some of their beautiful metalwork here. Courtyard scene. A young lady trying to sell me some jewelry, necklaces. And here's one of the real unique things about Africa. The vehicle in front of us is a horse-drawn BP oil tanker. Looks like he may be carrying diesel. Typical French road design with a roundabout one sees all over Africa. It's a truckload of baskets. Light load, but very high. And this is the important tourist hotel with some English ladies you can see walking back after their shopping. The European storks nesting on a battlement or chimney in a wall. These storks commute between Northern Europe and Morocco every year. The inside of a palace with beautiful orchards of fragrant oranges, lemons, citrus fruit, reflecting ponds. This must have really been some sight a few hundred years ago. Battlements of the palace. Here we are back at the airport. Great picture of the plane with the high Andes in the background. It's really an extraordinary setting. We're about to fly to Agadir, which is right on the coast, which has since gotten a Club Med resort. Mountains, sand, and ocean, all in a narrow area. We are at Agadir. The terminal. There's not much to see in Agadir. We checked through customs and then flew off to Canary Islands. City of Las Palmas, and as we arrived there, there was a squall line coming through. Fairly heavy rain. It's a charming area. It doesn't attract many Americans, but it should. Very lovely islands off the coast of North Africa that have been managed by the Spanish for a very, very long time. When we arrived, a little jeep pulled up in front of us with a sign we assumed meant follow me. So we just followed him, since neither of us speak Spanish. From the hotel, Queen Elizabeth, or Isabella, I think it's called, in the heart of town. It's a very pretty town, quite modern, and sea breezes everywhere. Here's one of the most unique things I've ever seen, a fellow who had rigged a bicycle with a grinding wheel. He was grinding scissors and knives while you wait for a small fee. Sort of like the knife grinders we used to have years ago that walked up and down the streets pushing a cart. This fellow's got it all rigged on his bicycle. Very fancy modern building. The shoreline would remind one of Nice, the French Riviera. Back at the airport. Taking off across the most barren landscape you ever saw. Once you cross over the channel between Las Palmas and Africa, we came across the full Sahara. And here it is, the only relief inside are a few clouds drifting over towards the Atlantic. We were flying on to a place called Attar. Rock and sand and desert. As inhospitable as any place on Earth. There are, however, several important mines here. I believe iron ore comes from this immediate area. And great phosphorus deposits in this country. This was the old Spanish Sahara. It's now being contested by Algeria and Morocco, and it's been so for 25 years. Flying over downtown Atta. We landed at this lovely spot. We had to concern ourselves with a camel on the runway. We were supposed to give 72 hours notice, according to the guidebook, that we were going to land there, yet there's no communications at all. This was apparently a French military base at one time. I believe there was a little French jail here. It took us 30 or 40 minutes just to be able to find get some transportation to go into town. This is a wind-blown fly speck of a nothing in the middle of nowhere. The town hall, no one's there. Everything made of mud. This is the main hotel, not a window in it. No tables or chairs. You eat by sitting on cushions on the floor. Billion flies. And the locals were convinced we were important visitors because they expected a eclipse of the sun in a few months, and they knew a bunch of scientists would be coming. They thought we were scientists, kind of an advance party. Here's a mosque in town, quite pretty, again made of mud. Jack, with a couple of our entourage, one of them owned a truck and drove us into town from the airport, and we were looking for fuel. At this point, everyone determined we had to see the captain. So these gentlemen took us to the captain. This may be the captain's family with one of those powerful two-horse Citroens. They call them Du Chavel, I believe. This relaxed fellow leaning against the plane is the captain. He spoke Arabic and some French. The fellow to his right is apparently a civil servant and the local head of the civil service He's also the meteorologist. He's wearing a native costume. Talking to Jack, he didn't speak 10 words of English, but they asked me if I had 72-hour permission to land there, and I said, of course. It seemed to pacify them. The fellow on the far left, whose size you don't really get a grip on here, immense black fellow who looked like he could have been the greatest linebacker of all times. If George Halas had seen him, he would have kidnapped him. But this is the sergeant. The sergeant seemed to know how to run some of the machinery, so we're at the airport, and the sergeant, who's wearing pantaloons, that's not a dress, is trying to get the machinery going to get us some 100-octane fuel. I've been told that Muslim men wore pantaloons because Muhammad is coming back to earth and will be born to a man. Because men don't know how to have babies, they wear the pantaloons so he doesn't drop on the ground. Here we are milling about trying to get the gasoline into the plane, and we can't seem to get it going. Those are all men dressed with this African garb. You can now get the size of this brute in the center. I would guess about 6'4 or 6'5, must have weighed 240, 250. That's me on the right, civil servant next to me, the captain leaning against the plane, and the George Halas candidate. Despite the heat, is well wrapped up next to the plane. They're all very fascinated with us. They don't get many visitors. The reason we came here was to see an area called the Chingredi, which was nearby, where 300,000 Arabs camp each year to trade daughters for dates or whatever they do, arrange marriages and do some trading. But it's in the high open desert, and before we can get there, we've got to get off the ground, and again, there's a camel on the runway. Flying over what an area we believe was the Chingredi. There were maybe 30 or 50 people down below. No activity. It was obviously the wrong time of year. We're thousands of feet above them. Get an idea how clear the sky is. Then we headed to Nouakchott, the capital of Mauritania, the country we were in. Nouakchott is an extraordinary place with 50% of the population still slaves. Horribly impoverished, nothing much going on. We wanted to land there, and I wanted to look up one of my bank director's daughter, a lady by the name of Nancy Jones, who was married to an Arab chieftain's son, who apparently was on and off a communist and in and out of jail, and very confusing to the Western mind. She's actually, while Norman Jones, my director, was the head of nuclear data, an important physicist. His first wife was a Spanish gal. He was born in England, and his daughter is English. Although in my book, I refer to her as a pretty American girl. She apparently considers herself English, even though her father lived in the States for God knows how many years. Here's the tower at Nouakchott, the capital of Mauritania, on the Atlantic Ocean. This is the airport. Not a great deal to see. Then all of a sudden, after screwing around for 30, 40 minutes, as we're ready to take off, Nancy Jones turns up with two big tribesmen, and one on either side of her. And I had never met her before. I have since seen her, I believe, twice. Once at her father's funeral in Barrington Hills. She came from Paris at the time. Very nice lady. And kept me thinking, my God, what if she wants to escape from this place? Do we put her in the back of the plane? But at any rate, she didn't. We still haven't refueled since leaving Las Palmas. There is no place to stay in Nouakchott. As the French say, it's complete. And rather than sleep in the plane or under the plane, we decided to fly on to Dakar in Senegal, even though it meant landing at dusk, which we didn't like, since we're leaving the desert into rough country. We had great difficulty landing, finally got there. That town was complete too. Could find no place to stay, but a fellow at the airport, the fellow on the left, is a French contractor and a flyer, sympathized with us and said, well, come with me. And we went to his house where he had some friends, including black airport officials and visiting French travelers. And they fed us a big meal late in the evening. We were exhausted. There's Jack on the right, and on the left is Gerald, and in the center is a young French girl with a three-month-old monkey who hated males. The monkey was very much in love with this French gal and shouting at Jack at that point. Here we are in this room filled with Frenchmen and natives. They tried for several hours to get us a room, couldn't. And finally, our host said, look, you can sleep in the shed in the back there. There are a couple of beds back there. And this was in his work yard. And he put us up for the night, for which we were eternally grateful. Interestingly enough, this is the only time that Jack and I had to sleep in the same bedroom during the whole trip. Visiting the museum in Senegal, modern art museum, with art I didn't particularly like. This is the University of Dakar. We were stuck there for several days because we dinged one of our propellers and Jack wouldn't go on without getting a new one, so it had to be shipped from Paris. This is Dakar, a very famous coastal city, probably the most important entrepot for slaves in northern Africa. You have to go all the way to Nigeria to find a place that shipped off as many slaves. And we're able to visit the sites in the area while we waited for a new propeller. There's one of those young French ladies, I think she was a school teacher, the local kids. A whole market filled with the skins of hundreds of crocodiles, which are illegal to bring into the States. They're high on the list of prohibited animals, but they're sold openly along the shoreline at Senegal. An artisan carving something for the market for tourists. Another one weaving for tourists. The women dress in probably the most imaginative gowns and colors we've ever seen. Just astonishing. The gentlemen on the left there are both dressed in white kaftan, sort of the typical robe they wear, which works quite well in the tropics. Keeps them cool. You can see the color of the woman's clothes, just amazing. There's the beach at Henebry, which was the most famous slave depot in the world. Our hotel. And right on this site is where the slaves were brought from the interior by the local natives and then sold to the Arabs. Transship them to generally the West Indies or maybe even to the what's now continental U.S. Three fellows in the background on the left there are all flyers. First one is the Frenchman who was our host. In front of him, the girl is his Vietnamese mistress. Between the two of them is an English flyer, and behind the Vietnamese girl is a Dutch flyer. And the fellow next to Jack is an airport official. We were made honorary members of the Aero Club of Dakar. They treated us like royalty. It was very enjoyable. They did everything they could for us. This powerful substitute Rolls-Royce is a two-horse Citroen. Our host gave us the driver on the right to drive us around. He told me he paid $50 for the vehicle. It was used, beat up, had a motor as big as a sewing machine, and only 2 horsepower. The driver was sensational, however. And there he is again. He was a very religious Muslim. Whenever we stopped, he whipped out his prayer rug and started praying. Couldn't speak a word of English, but we got along. Jack thought he was the greatest native since Gunga Din. From Dakar, we flew to Bamako, the capital of Mali, which would allow us to get to Timbuktu, a place we've always heard of and wanted to see. The airport at Bamako. This is the hotel we stayed at, the Lido. It looked like it belonged on the set of Beau Geste. Lots of French colognes. Colonists are known as colognes. Beautiful open dining area and the most astonishing nightclub on the grounds I've ever seen, called the Daltons, inside of which there were 100 Clint Eastwood posters and other Western artifacts. The people who used that nightclub were all the children, the 20-year-old children of the French colonists. And here is the greatest fixer in town, Mr. Gamba, who was going to be our guide and take us around. And I mean, this guy's a fixer. His office is filled with contraband, cigarettes, cigars, booze, you name it. He's a wheeler dealer fixer. When we arrived in town, we didn't know it was prohibited to take pictures. And we whipped out our Nikons and started taking pictures. A young German boy, tourist, started telling me in English and German it was prohibited to take pictures in the airport or anywhere else. He told us to put away your cameras before they take them. This is from the roof of Mr. Gamba's office. Here's the city of Bamako. It is absolutely nothing. And villagers living right near the city. Mighty Niger River, which flows at this place to the north, then swings around and comes south. Great numbers of women come to the Niger to do their laundry. And even though it was prohibited to take any pictures, that bridge particularly was sensitive because they thought it was a military target. This is a big hotel, I think a 12 or 15 stories hotel, built by the people of Egypt as a gift to the people of Mali. The people of Mali are big for accepting gifts. We saw a Soviet stadium, we saw an American school, and we saw this hotel. This hotel's relatively strategically located. At the time, they couldn't get anyone to manage it. There was no tourist traffic. No one wanted to take it over and run it. Probably 15 years later, at a function in Chicago, I was seated next to Diane Sawyer, the newscaster who had just come back from Bamako. And she said she stayed in the hotel and it was open. Downtown Bamako, driving around. It took some doing, but Jack ran into the local airline head, whose founder and the head in America was an old Air Force pal of his, who got us permission to fly on to Timbuktu. Here we are in the air, flying over the Great Niger River. On the way to Timbuktu, you pass another historic town called Jene. This is the only reality in this part of Africa, is the Niger River. I mean, without it, there could be no life. We're coming into Timbuktu, which at one time was on the Niger River. The river has since retreated 4 miles to the south, and by the time we get to Timbuktu, the river was only a memory. Desolate beyond belief. Everything made of mud. However, in the 8th century, it was considered by the Arab world as the center of intellectual achievement. Had a university. The airport in downtown Timbuktu, a place everyone's heard of. Now, at the airport, we were greeted by a tall, thin Frenchman by the name of Jacques de Fleury, who spoke broken English and helped us whenever he could because he wanted to get out of there. Told us to put away the cameras. He had to get us permission first. So he took us to the police chief and the mayor, and everyone signed the documents and we had permission to take pictures. Town Square, which is the typical French roundabout, probably as big as Red Square in Moscow, half a mile across, and no traffic. And here's an official building. I think this is the Place de Meyer. Here's how the poor people live in Timbuktu, under tents made of hides. Would remind one of the way the slaves lived at Naksha. Vast oceans of sand. A few donkeys, a few camels. Now, anything can live in this climate is beyond me. It had not rained in 4 years when we arrived. And yet, it would appear every animal is nibbling at something. Maybe they eat sand, I don't know. Camels look fit and healthy. And a goat. There's a marketplace. two handsome-looking beasts. Really fine-looking camels. Waiting for the action. The sun was so bright, we each had Nikon F2s, and we had 25 ASA film. A relatively slow film. But our readings called for us to take pictures at a 2/1000th of a second. I've never in my life seen anything like it. The brightness was that great, it was like taking a picture directly at the sun. This is a unique area in that women aren't necessarily covered up, their faces are not covered up, but the males are. And they are known as Taregs. And they wear dark blue cloths. They live in the desert. They're fierce and rough looking. These are tough looking cookies. You can take a look at this bugger, you just wouldn't want to meet him in a dark alley. This is a mosque in town. Again, beautiful architecture, made out of mud with sticks. This is the local scenery. Walls around each important home. Nothing to eat. This is the town of Timbuktu. Here's a Tuareg about to take off across the desert. Locals. Somebody selling pots and pans. Looks like a bunch of merchants trying to sell things to one another. Everything made with mud bricks. And there's someone with a watermelon on the left. Look at the flowing gown. And here's where the bricks come from. Someone has got a brick manufacturing plant in a pit about 40 feet deep, and they objected to our taking pictures of it, but we did anyway. And here fellas are bringing water up from the pit to make the bricks. This water must seep all the way from the old Niger riverbed. Here's the brick manufacturing. A lot of livestock in the background ready to go across the desert. Starting to move out. There goes a Tuareg off on a journey. These trees haven't had water in 4 years. God knows how deep their roots go. Here's a pretty little girl selling something or other. Again, Tuareg's trying to sell something. My friend Jacques de Fleury on the right with the lady bartender or whatever she was in the hotel, the only hotel in town. Planes would come in every day bringing tourists for an hour or two and then fly back to Bamako, and people would eat a meal at this hotel. It's the only place in town. That's de Fleury in the background. He was trying to send a cable onto Dakar telling people that his plans were changed, that he was flying out with us. Here's de Fleury's caravan, Jacques Nouveau on the front. These two great Mercedes trucks, which crossed probably 800 or 1,000 miles of desert in the background. Very formidable weapons, these trucks. De Fleury with his wife Claude, a lovely lady, flew in to some remote spot and met them several days before they arrived at Timbuktu. When we got her back to Bamako, she washed her hair 3 times in an hour, trying to get the dust and sand out of it. And all she could talk about was her hairdresser in Paris. Loading up the truck to go on to Dakar. Note the front of the truck with the goatskin water bag. It's filled with water and it cools down, an antique way of air conditioning. And also notice the Cross of Lorraine. Both Jacques de Fleury and Jacques Nouveau, his best buddy, were officers in the Gaul forces in World War II. There's Jacques de Fleury smiling as his crew takes off for Dakar. He's also going to save 8 days by flying to Bamako with us. Myself on the left, DeFleury's wife, Claude, Jacques DeFleury, and the fellow getting in the truck is his boat captain who navigated all the way across the desert. Another going away scene. Jacques Nouveau driving off in one of the trucks. And the boat captain in the second truck. There was an interesting thing that happened. This small caravan came into Mali. They apparently entered Mali, some remote desert town where a former president of the country was being held as a prisoner. And the army surrounded them, thinking they may have been there to liberate him. But they had no firearms and were released. From Bamako, in the high desert, we headed toward Abidjan. This was remarkable as we left the high desert at Bamako, and on the way south to the rainforest, you could feel the humidity build up in the airplane. There's our plane in the background with Jack and about 20 pounds of maps in front of him. These people are pilgrims coming or going to Mecca. This was the religious season. I believe it's Ramadan. Well, I'm not certain, but they make the trip, which all devout Muslims must make one time in their life, to visit Mecca. The white robes symbolize that they've been there. This is the great and famous hotel, more than 25 stories high, in Abidjan, built in the tropics with a fantastic infrastructure. Abidjan is the capital of the Ivory Coast. This picture is probably from the 15th floor onto a swimming pool below. You can see the miasma from the fantastic heat. It's 95% humidity and probably 100 degrees out. Gigantic tree, must have been 200 feet high there overlooking the scene. The harbor, again, the effects of heat in the distance. Here we are dining in a world-class restaurant in the hotel. You can see we're dressed now for the tropics. We no longer wear jackets. Street scene. Colorful. Merchants and people traveling about. Ladies seem to wear fantastic outfits. A baby on the back and a load on the roof. Here I am at the Nigerian embassy. Despite the 50 or so visas we had, we never got one to visit Nigeria. So when we were in Abidjan, we determined to visit the embassy and meet the ambassador. We ran into the typical functionaries one runs into. And because we're starting to get experienced in this thing, we filled out the applications. I left my card, letting them know I was a banker. And then we retired and went to the American embassy to see if we had any mail. Recognizing that the girl, who was extraordinarily officious, would probably relax and go in and see the ambassador. Precisely what happened. When we returned, we were welcomed. We got our visas and flew on to the capital of Nigeria, Lagos. This is one of the world's most unpleasant places. The stench outside the airport from rotting copra would knock an elephant down. Copra is a drying coconut. We flew on from Lagos, which we had to enter, it's the only port of entry in the country, to Benin City, which was the heart of the slave trade in the area, and a very historic city with famous bronzes that the British discovered when they invaded the place in the late 19th century. This is the Ubu's Palace, and officials in front. When the Brits came here, people showed their wealth by having slaves impaled in front of their house, rotting. And if you were very rich, you might have several. The poor people might impale a dog on a stake to show that they too were in the game. This is a new museum which was going to hold what artifacts the British didn't take to London, and it had not as yet opened when we were there, but our taxi driver was able to wangle us in to see it, which caused an eruption when some guard came along and chewed out unmercifully the taxi driver that this was not a public place and wouldn't be for another week. We tried to calm him down by offering the film we had, but he merely wanted to show power over the other black fellow, which is a typical African device of showing authority. A typical scene of a baby on the back of a woman. Colorful dresses on the women. Another baby, one under a parasol or umbrella, I guess you call it. Here are some nurses from the local hospital, obviously having a good time. There was a medical meeting that night in town, and it's worth knowing that for the doctors to have air conditioning in their hotel ballroom, they had to turn off all the power of the rest of the town. Here is a street scene, boys with billows trying to blow air on charcoal for a bronze statue manufacturer. They use what's known as the lost wax method of casting. From there, we wanted to see Dr. Schweitzer's hospital at Lambrini, but to get there, we had to flow against the Bight of Biafra. When we arrived at Libreville, we were greeted by the gentleman on the left, who was the local fixed base owner, and on the right is his wife, who Jack is smiling at. We're at dinner that night in the Intercontinental Hotel, having a cocktail before. The gentleman on the left really did a job getting us clearance and reassuring the secret police that we were not agents provocateur. One of the interesting things was the police knew about the Coca-Cola plane, and they knew about the International Harvester plane. They didn't believe that an individual could own a plane. When we got up the next day, it was 95 to 100 degrees. We were going to fly over the jungle to Lambrini, and we were roasting in our clothes, and Henebry said, we should do what I did in New Guinea in the old days when we were about to go on a bombing run and it was so hot. We'd take our pants off. So we did. We flew in our shorts. Here we are over the Ogeni River coming into Lambrini. Downtown Lambrini. There's absolutely nothing there. A few yards away is the river and the crossing. We saw a beautiful young woman with a baby, nursing a baby, but she saw our camera, she covered up. And here are apparently merchants carrying their inventory around on their shoulders along the river edge. These are the yachts we used to get across the river. Aubrey and I were able to get one for just the two of us. You just see how soaked I am, this incredible humidity. Schweitzer's Hospital from the river with a very wide-angle lens. This is probably a 20-millimeter lens. Henebry in the front of the boat with his pants on. Here's a new boat being carved along the shore. Schweitzer's Hospital. There was a lecture going on as we came and a doctor listening to it. French is the language spoken here. Schweitzer was an Alsatian with multiple degrees, a great musicologist, probably the world's leading authority on Bach. He had degrees and doctorates in law, philosophy, music, and late in life he wanted to do something for humanity and got a degree in medicine and came to Lambrini. This is the exterior of the house he lived in. There are only two Americans living there at this time. One gentleman who is known as Papa, we're looking at his back here, was pointing out where the great doctor played his organ. Schweitzer was very, very old-fashioned and would not allow indoor plumbing anywhere around. Within a year of his death, the medical staff installed plumbing. This fellow had been an accountant for one of the movie studios. He was originally German-born, a Jew, and met his wife in the 20s when she visited Hamburg. The two of them love it there, although she suffers from the malaria medication. This is a nurse who rode a bicycle from North Africa all the way through the jungle down to work for Lambrini. I believe she's a Dutch lady. And there she is walking away. She didn't want to be interviewed. She was probably the last person who remembered Schweitzer, who died years before. One of the most extraordinary things that we went to lunch with the staff, they all spoke French, mostly German doctors speaking French, and the meal astonished me. It was the kind of meal one would expect in Alsace in the heat of winter. boiling hot potatoes, boiling hot fish, cabbage. Very heavy, hot meal when it's 100 degrees out and no air conditioning. Schweitzer and his wife's graves on the ground. New wards being built up on the hill. Schweitzer, who understood Africa very well, made sure that everyone paid for medical services he gave them. He would not do anything free. If you brought a chicken, that would do it, no matter how big your operation was or how much care you needed. But whoever came had to bring his family with him, and the family lived in the open between wards and cooked for them. Most of these people had never been in a building or gone up a flight of stairs in their lives. The laundry being done between two wards. Nurses cleaning up an operating room. There they are scrubbing with alcohol an operating room, along with the American guide we had. The operating room. The inside of a ward. They have outstanding sanitation considering where they are. I asked the question is, what's the worst disease there? And strangely, it was misinterpreted, and our guide told us hernias. It turned out that it's the number one problem in the area, and Schweitzer thought that the people had degenerated because they didn't work and lived on fruit and had easy living in the jungle and never did any exercise. As a consequence, they degenerated in physical well-being. View of the shore. A woman patient with a small burden on her head and elephantiasis in her legs. It's the first time I'd ever seen elephantiasis. Our guide saying goodbye to us. When we got back to the States, I wrote the hospital and sent them some money and told our trust department to keep them in mind for people who don't know where to leave money to. Someday I would like to give them a major gift. Here we are back at the airport. This is the airport at Libreville. We're at the Intercontinental Hotel. We then flew from Libreville to Luanda. We flew along the shore, and below you can see the mouth of the Congo River, the great river of Africa, other than the Nile. We're coming into Luanda, which is a beautiful regional city settled by the Portuguese 500 years ago. Lovely town, beautifully well kept. The local workers at the airport, first question they asked us is, do we have any Playboy magazines? The church is very heavy-handed, and the administration was very heavy-handed on pornography. I returned there a few years after Portuguese were thrown out, and I've never seen as much pornography on newsstands anywhere in the world. This is a statue in the heart of town of Vasco da Gama, the great explorer. In the heart of town, we stayed at a hotel that had been open 1 week. This is the most beautiful building in Africa, pink, Portuguese colonial. It's the central bank, the Bank of Angola. Beautiful shore, lots of modern buildings, beautifully well-kept up city, plantings everywhere, and well-maintained by the locals. Just below the battlements of a old fortification that's several hundred years old. Another scene of the harbor. A scene of the city late afternoon. Dusk looking towards the town from the battlements. We met several people at the hotel who offered to show us the sights the next day, and we flew by air trying to look for giant sable and elephants. This is the first village we spotted, a typical African village with rondavels, round, lightweight walls, landing strip, one plane ready to go. There are some antelope, probably eland, down below us. Another little village. One of the locals had a boat, took us out in the harbor, and we went over to an island across the harbor. where I picked up a few shells I'd never seen before. This took 40 minutes to get the boat offloaded. Getting ready to get in the boat. This was the island out in the bay. From Luanda, we went on down to Nuevo Lisboa, considered the Chicago of Angola, a large manufacturing area, town of maybe 100,000 or more, in the highlands south of Luanda. You can get an idea of the manufacturing. Here we are talking to a Portuguese who was alerted to meet us and show us around, get us a hotel. We slept across the street from the railroad station and were kept awake all night by old locomotives going back and forth. No diesels around, just old-fashioned choo-choos. Street scene with Jack getting a shoe shine. Probably cost one peseta or 10 cents. Back at the airport, ready to go south again. Now we are over desert again. This is the Great Kalahari as we wind our way down to Southwest Africa, going to land and refuel at Windhoek, and then on down to Cape Town, all in the same day. Get an idea of the rough scenery below. Here we are coming into Windhoek. Absolute remote, means windy spot. This was formerly German Southwest Africa, but they lost it in World War I, and the South Africans have had the mandate to run it ever since, or they had up till this time. It's now Namibia. All we did is refuel. River emptying into the sea. I believe this is the Orange River. Flying on down to Cape Town, and it's now getting dark. We've been in the air all day. Famous Table Mountain at dusk. The area near the airport, we're trying to get in before dark. Your airport at Cape Town. The only vehicle we were able to get at the airport was a Volkswagen Beetle with the shift on the wrong side and the driving on the wrong side, and it was very foreign to us. The only place we could spend the night was in a suburban area. The town was packed. No room in the good hotels. So we stayed at a suburban Holiday Inn. One of the most beautiful cities in Africa. This is the heart of Cape Town. The tall building on the right is the Herengracht Hotel, which we later got into. Marvelous place. Great city. Looking over the town from a hotel room. This is the Mount Nelson Hotel, which favored by the Brits. Cape Town was a British city until probably the 1930s when the Boers took over the whole country and formed the Union of South Africa Republic. This is a lovely hotel grounds. We went there for lunch. We met some English-speaking people who offered to take us to the racetrack. From our hotel, see the harbor out there? Cape of Good Hope. This is one of the really interesting phenomena. It was not uncommon to see a white man driving a taxi that said blacks only, or a black man driving a taxi that would only seat whites. Racial discrimination, apartheid was in full flower. Beautiful town in the tropics, lovely area. The shore would remind one of Cannes or Nice. A pool cut right out of live rock. The track is broken into four elements. We are in the members area. Then there is the clubhouse for white people, a place for what are known as colored, which are mostly Indians or Asians, and a fourth area for blacks. Betting is handled on both paramutual and with bookies. You can see the tote board. Right. There's a fantastic wind comes from the Cape right into the face of the horses, and horses that have never encountered this run very badly. Here's our host with a couple of young English girls and myself. The name of this racetrack is Milnerston, named after a former governor of the province, English governor. plane north towards Kimberley, the site of the Great Diamond Mine. Over Kimberley, on the right is the Big Hole. During the Boer War, the Brits were surrounded by the Boers. Boers brought up a giant cannon they called Long Tom and started shelling Kimberley. The chief engineer of the Kimberley Mines, an American, got a guidebook on building a cannon and built the cannon on the right, which was even bigger, and called it Long Cecil for Cecil Rhodes. Here's the description of the mines. The old infrastructure. One of the guards at the mines, a person of no particular distinction, started collecting African artifacts and built the finest collection in South Africa, which he put into a museum. It's a remarkable collection of masks and artifacts that the natives used from a number of tribes. You can get an idea of some of the things he collected. You will note my mustache is coming along pretty well by this time. Here again is the usual thing, white men, and there'll be another sign for another washroom for black men. Cecil Rhodes Pullman Railroad car, built in Chicago, shipped to Africa for his use. On the trip, we never passed a golf course that Henebry didn't want to take a look and a picture. It was under construction 30 years ago. It's the New World headquarters of De Beers, and they expected ultimately to be selling all the diamonds right from here. Whether they have or not, I don't know. I'm under the impression they still sell them in London and Amsterdam. This is sort of like a town you would expect in the United States, a Western town. This was a frontier town with miners and everything that miners would bring with them, whiskey, cards, women, gambling, all the vices known to man. Beautifully done. Old locomotive. Model town, the old town as it existed more than 100 years ago, Kimberley. This is a non-European waiting room. I'm sure they're not real, but probably paste copies of some very important diamonds in various colors and shapes, sizes. Shows how diamonds are cut. Big handfuls of them, and how they grow in the kimberlite. The big hole again, and a smaller hole next to it. Jack flying the plane shows what can be done with a wide-angle lens. Over the city, those yellow piles are tailings of gold mines. The whole town is filled with these. Joburg is a big industrial city and of no particular charm. Where Kimberley was the diamond mining area, Johannesburg was the center of the gold production and still is. We've now left Johannesburg and are flying to Victoria Falls. This is the Great Zambezi River, and what appears to be clouds is actually spray coming up from the falls. There was a war going on the other side of the falls, so we were very careful in flying over the falls. This fall is considerably larger than Niagara, although isn't as easy to see as Niagara. There's an idea of how impressive it looks from a distance. You can imagine what Dr. Livingston thought when he saw this. This is one of the great sights of Africa, without question. The airport. And here we are at our hotel. We're about to walk on down to the falls, and you'll note we have our raincoats because of the spray. It just goes up and onto you. And you should be in a bathing suit. I mean, you're about to get a swim without getting into water. Our guide, a fine fellow, has taken his fez off. But later, while wearing his fez, I thought he had wounded himself since it was red appeared to be blood running down the side of his face. It was just the dive from his fez. This is the main falls. Maximum, the spray will go 450 meters into the air. Mighty high. Just above the falls as they get ready to plummet over the parapet. Here's a railroad that goes from Rhodesia into Zambia. We're on the Rhodesia side, now Zimbabwe, and there was a war going on between the two countries, but despite the fact the war was going on, trade continued. Typical situation to try to avoid the devastation of having no commerce. Dr. David Livingston, the first white man to see the falls, and named him after Queen Victoria. This is the hotel we stayed at, the Elephant Hills Hotel. Back in the plane, heading to Bulawayo. From Victoria Falls, we went to Fort Victoria to see the Zimbabwe ruins. Rhodesia is now called Zimbabwe, named after these ruins. We're outside the town of Bulawayo. Beautiful split rock. And some prehistoric drawings by early humans of game animals. Beautiful artistry. Another cave. And more cave drawings. Thousands of years old. Here we are at a place known as the View of the World. We're going to the grave of Cecil John Rhodes, the founder of the country. And this is his gravestone on top of a great granite rock of immense size. Game park nearby, lions lying on the road. Rather tame, they know they're not hunted. These are best shots of lions while we were in Africa. A zebra that stuck his head right into the car. That's right against the window of the car. A remarkable little animal called a clipspringer, right on a granite kopje and its mate down below. Here is one of the most beautiful animals of Africa. This is a young male sable. Guinea fowl. Guinea hens, we would call them in America. And this is Fitzgerald Street in Bulawayo. We're now at Fort Victoria. We've landed near there, and we're going to the Zimbabwe National Ruins. Rhodesia has changed its name to Zimbabwe. Local lady making a meal, I gather. Here I am coming out of a small hut by the ruins. This is a vast complex. It goes on for several hundred acres in my view, the heart of which takes maybe 10 acres. Probably built 1,000 years ago. The local whites do not think the blacks designed or built it. The blacks take credit. Very well built walls leading up to a temple, what is called the temple. These walls go about as as high as 30 feet, have some ornamentation at the top, and there's considerable evidence there was gold mining in the immediate area. You can see how high some of these structures are. Narrow passages, probably about 4 or 5 feet wide between buildings. To leave the country of Rhodesia, we must check through a port of entry, and we went through a place called Buffalo Range. Incredibly verdant spot. Incidentally, it's worth knowing that Americans were not allowed to go to Rhodesia at that era, and so to avoid having a stamp put in our passports, the Rhodesians stapled a brown piece of paper and stamped that in our passports. They were very sensitive and grateful we came, but we had to go through the rigmarole to go to the next country, Mozambique. I would like to point out, at Buffalo Range, before we left, a chief flew in his own airplane and had a young, beautiful black girl with him, who apparently was a model, and had an Afro hairdo, one of the few we ever saw in Africa. She probably got it out of LA Magazine. He was not allowed to leave the plane, and he was a great cattle baron somewhere in the area. We then flew on to Beira, which is an undistinguished place on the coast of Mozambique, and had permission to fly to the great Gorongosa Park. In Gorongosa, the village is fenced in to keep the animals out, and we landed on this grass strip after buzzing it to chase the animals off. Now we came back to the town, and they opened the gates and let us in so the hyenas wouldn't eat our tires or the elephants lean on the wings. And here are our rooms. This is really rainforest country, dripping wet, humidity very, very, very high. And in the back of each hotel room, they had what they called a donkey, a little charcoal boiler that they would heat up water so you had hot water. That's the donkey. Here's a verdant park in the hotel grounds. They had a swimming pool there. I wanted to take a swim, and it was like swimming in soup. Had to be 110 degrees, the water. Not particularly refreshing. Next morning, we got in one of the vehicles they provide and started touring. Here's an elephant. While riding this truck, with all the engine vibrations and all, it was difficult to take pictures. So we asked the truck driver to stop the truck. He would not. He apparently had been rolled over or hit by elephants, and he is in no mood to ever stop the engine. This one could be dangerous because you can see the dripping musk from his musk glands. That means he's in breeding mode, or the rut. Fantastic sunsets in the area. Another cabin available inside the park. It's what's known as a rondavel. The Africans build round houses so no evil spirits can hide in corners. Here is a close-up of a sizable hippo gorging himself on the water lilies or water whatever. Again, not spooky, more hippos. The word hippopotamus comes from the Greek, meaning river horse, but it's hardly a member of the horse family. It's more closely related to the pig family. Inside the park, you ride around in trucks, and they're certainly not harassed in any way. So they go about their business, you go about yours. Lions are never disturbed by people in a vehicle. It's only if you determine to get out that you're in danger. Male ostrich. The males have dark feathers, the blackish, and the females are gray. There's a pair. Quite a beautiful bird. The ostrich is the only bird in existence with an external penis. A lioness may have found something interesting. A large herd of antelope watching her. A game in the Gorongosa. beautiful, relatively young water buck. And there's a female water buck. Cape buffalo. Very timid, quiet, but dangerous if hunted. These are Egyptian geese. Baboons on the road. And a small monkey. Some more monkeys grooming one another. These are very young warthogs. There's an impala buck with a bird eating ticks or bugs off his hide. Game across the river in the Gorongosa Park. Here's an eagle. Our truck must have spooked him off a tree. He's flying away. A wildebeest. It seems to be the most common animal in Africa, I swear. Here's elephants again. Occasionally they look a little touchy, which clearly concerned the driver. Jack and I were in the back of the truck with 300mm lenses on our Nikons. We had to take pictures when you're moving at a 250th of a second. You can't take them any slower, so this occasionally caused problems with f-stops. Fever trees in the background. You would never get this close to elephants in the wild. These are game park elephants. A small impala buck. More game. Several varieties milling about together. Zebras. There are few animals more charming than a baby zebra. Absolutely beautiful. And here is a young cheetah. We took off from Gorongosa, flew back to Beira, checked through customs, and flew to Bandier, the capital of Malawi. We refueled through the good auspices of a gentleman by the name of Dennis Weavis, Englishman, and started north when we ran into weather, an hour or so up on the flight, and we had to turn back. We didn't dare go into Tanzania with the storm on, and so we flew back. Weavis again met us at the airport. He and his wife invited us to their home for cocktails and made arrangements for us to spend the night in Blantyre. They were a wonderful couple. She was a former stew. He's the head of the airport at Blantyre. Nice folks, referred to us as former colonials. Gassing up again. We flew up the next morning from Blantyre and refueled at Tabora, which was in Tanzania. This was German East Africa, and flew over the Serengeti to Nairobi. A long day's trip. A hotel roof overlooking Nairobi. Quite a modern city. It's Nairobi Game Park, which is a few miles outside of town. Unfortunately, even 30 years ago, most of the game had been poached out of the park. The natives love venison, and so there's not a great deal to see. There seem to be plenty of female lions. There's one taking a dump. There's the boss. There's the big guy relaxing. This is a hartebeest known as Koch's hartebeest, or Gorgoni it's called by the locals. A couple of jackals out hunting. And the ubiquitous giraffe. Giraffes have an immense pair of horns. Doesn't look as formidable as you might think, but you occasionally will see two males scarred from clashing. Now here's a real warthog. Pretty nice trophy, as a matter of fact. About 10-inch tusks, he'd be a beautiful mount. And because I'm a banker, I was always interested in taking pictures of banks. And here's a local branch of the Kenya Commercial Bank. could use a little paint. Now we've met my round hunter, Ikram Hassan, who's a Pakistani, who is going to be my professional hunter. Henebry has gone on to Switzerland to visit his daughter, Mary Henebry, who was, I believe, in school in Switzerland at the time. He went to Geneva and came back about 8 or 10 days later. This is the truck I hunted out of. And here we are at dinner. We had waiters, cooks, dishwashers, valets, a fellow who did nothing but iron clothes. A large staff, probably 20 people to take care of you on a safari. Very civilized. And that's the Biffy. And here's a little village on the roads you go through, and on your way between hunting areas, we'll visit some of these small villages that have one store probably. A Maasai cattle. These are young Maasai males known as morans. They keep that designation during their youth before they marry, and they drive the cattle around and their little brothers help them. They always have a spear. The Maasai walking about. And this is our camp. There's a lot of meat we've shot drying. It's being stored in the open air. Once it hardens up instantly and is not subject to any fly problems or anything else after a few minutes in the hot air. This can be thrown into water and reconstitutes quickly. Here are marabou storks hanging around trying to steal some of the meat that's drying on trees. Charcoal, very big business over there. Here's Ikram Hassan calling his wife, who lives in Mombasa, a big radio rig to do so. This was the way to communicate 30 years ago. This is the famous Mount Kilimanjaro, tallest mountain in Africa. This is one of the first animals I shot. A Grant's gazelle. Beautiful impala buck. Please note the band-aid on my nose. In one of my early shots, I got what is commonly known as a Weatherby eye. I crawled into the scope and it hit back, smashed my sunglasses, and left me with a cut. Here's Henneby's shotgun and a small bird that's known as a Franklin. Typically likes to run ahead of the truck, doesn't like to fly as much as it likes to run. This is one of our gun bearers. We called him Michelin. These fellows use cut-up tires for shoes. If you want to sneak up on game, they slide out of their shoes. This is a lesser bustard, a game bird over there. And pretty good eating. We are with Ikram Hassan's nephew, and I believe another impala buck. This is vindication of Robert Ardlee's book, The Territorial Imperative, with hundreds of weaver birds in one bush while the vacant bushes are all empty. An African eagle. The vultures. Vultures find meat by a sense of smell generally, but when you're in an active hunting area, they know when they hear a shot what it means. This is the first zebra I ever shot. He had clearly been hit by a lion or lioness probably 10, 12 days before and had been badly scratched up and was hiding out with a group of giraffes. Quite by accident, we spotted him, and it was not a difficult stalk. The other zebras, when they would hear a truck, would take off from miles away. We are skinning the zebra. Fold it up, and then we leave it to the birds to finish up. Here's a male ostrich. Jack flew in where we were hunting at a strip known as Itu Andri. This is a little grass strip. He flew in after he came back from Geneva with a pilot who brought his wife and mother-in-law with him, and the fellow's name was Dickie Bird. Henebry later gave him 40 pounds of maps, which are very, very valuable over there since they can't be had. Jack and I greeting each other after 10 days or 2 weeks apart. This is Dickie Bird and his mother-in-law, and I believe his wife is behind me. There's Hassan's truck. Here we are back at camp. I believe our laundry boy is ironing there. He had a cast iron iron in which he put live coals in. Very old-fashioned, but very effective. Native lady smiling with her children. This is the giant baobab tree. It looks upside down. The branches look more like roots, but it's very soft, and the elephants, when stressed for water, get moisture out of it, and they can rip up a giant tree. It gives you an idea of the scale of these trees and what damage can be done by the elephants. There are three people inside a hole, eaten out by the elephants. This is my first buffalo in the wild. I shot at the one on the right and believed I nicked him in the right hindquarter, probably cut a tendon, and we've tracked him for 3 or 4 days and could never find him. Tracking a wounded buffalo is serious business. You must always be concerned that they'll work their way behind you. Hassan had been gored by a buffalo and survived it. Everyone is super cautious. There's Henebry, isn't interested. He's lying next to the car, taking a nap. Beautiful acacia trees, beautiful Kenya scenery. Hanging lion bait. These have to be placed at a certain height where the lion can just get at it, cannot pull it down, and hyenas cannot reach it. So it's quite an art form. We check the baits every day. There's one of our guides bathing in a river. Zebra, see how well they're camouflaged in that brush. It's a herd of Beza oryx. It's a different variety of oryx than we typically see. The typical oryx that you'll see on the walls of homes in the States are Gimbuk's oryx. This Beza oryx are unique to this part of Africa. Henebry, after a shower, I'm relaxing too. We had all the requirements for civilized living. This is the last animal I shot on the hunt. It's a very nice male water buck. Has very long hair, and as a gag, I had a golf bag made for Henebry out of it. It was a very difficult shot at dusk, and he was in a herd, and while I thought I had him in my sights, after I fired, Ikram turned to the boys and he said, "Did he get the right one?" And they all cheered, "He got the right one." Here's the trophies and a group picture as we're ready to break up. I don't rightly recall what this building is, except I think it's a church dedicated to Haile Selassie, or perhaps his tomb. we saw a little museum in one of these beautiful buildings that had a statue of Haile Selassie. He was roughly my height, where in actuality, he was probably about 5'2". But he's portrayed for any viewers as being about 5'10". This is a typical Christian cemetery, probably of distinctly upper class, maybe nobles. The country's long history of Christianity clearly embedded everything one sees. A beautiful angel on the left in front of the church. Many tall buildings in the town. A lot of money has been pumped in here. Here's the Pan African Insurance Company. This is from our room in the Hilton Hotel. Please notice the swimming pool below us in the shape of a Coptic type cross. The country's been Christian since the 4th century, and you're reminded of that all the time. When we left Addis Ababa, it was our intention to go to the famous Lalibela on our way to Asmara. We charted a course based on the maps and couldn't find it. We spent a half hour looking for Lalibela, this beautiful village with many ornate churches carved out of solid rock as a result of King Lalibela visiting the Holy Land and seeing the Muslim influence. Decided that Jerusalem was finished and he was going to recreate it, a Christian center in his country. A remote mountain area, we could not find it, and so we headed to Asmara. And on the way to Asmara, all of a sudden we saw a landing strip. We landed at this remote place knowing it was probably Lalibela. We made an error. What we should have done is flown over the temples and they would have sent a jeep to pick us up. When I suggested to Jack that we take off again and fly over the town, he said, no way. With his low wings and all the rocks, he was afraid there'd be great damage to the plane. So he said, when we take off, we're gone. Went to the terminal. There was another plane there, you can see, and we had a few wandering tribesmen trying to sell Christian artifacts. The international terminal, rendezvous at Lalibela. High mountain desert, the only building we could see. Fortunately, no jeep came out to pick us up, and we spent a little time talking with these shepherds who were trying to sell artifacts. I bought a beautiful vellum page illustrated, they alleged several hundred years ago, for my daughter, who's an art professor. This is Lalibela from the air, and if you look closely, you can see buildings carved downward out of solid rock. More temples, there are probably a dozen of them. It's appeared in the National Geographic. It's very scenic, very remote, cannot be seen from the lower altitudes. And so you can see how King Lalibela knew he had a safe spot for Christianity. There are hundreds of monks live in this area. And we're sorry we weren't able to visit those temples. Coming into Asmara, which was part of Ethiopia at this moment in 1973, later became the major city in Somalia. Here's Jack in front of our plane. He was very pleased to come to Asmara because this was a great base of the MAC, Military Airlift Command, of which he's the vice chairman, vice commander, I should say. It was interesting to see our plane among all these giant military planes. Here is a typical street scene, and one you will not see very often, of men holding hands. And they do this regularly in Ethiopia and Somalia. There's no sign of sexual irregularity, but just a custom. Another great temple, but more modern. This area was long occupied by the Italians. The Italians have a great influence in the area. St. Mary's School. Typical street scene with women with babies. lovely square. Beautiful children.
Let's go play house.
And again, a market selling grains and produce. Very colorful, just as you would have seen in Morocco. Beautiful jacaranda tree. This is probably as pretty a tree as exists, and it was in bloom. Our plan was to fly from Asmara to Khartoum in the Sudan and on to Cairo. We did not have enough range to go directly from Asmara to Cairo, so we had to refuel at one point. As you may recall, there was a terrible incident with the Black September revolutionists who murdered the German and American chargé d'affaires and several other diplomats at a reception in Khartoum, and we were prohibited from flying to Khartoum. The State Department was sending us continuous messages not to go to Khartoum, so we had to refuel at Port Sudan on the Red Sea rather than going inland. And we ran into a considerable number of soldiers, mid-level officers, all of whom today you would say looked like cousins to Saddam Hussein. Again, ubiquitous camel on a runway. Amazing how you can live with that. From there we headed to the great city of Cairo. While in the air, two or three times we were cautioned that we had drifted off course and had to get back on course. This is Cairo in the evening at sunset from the Cairo Hilton Hotel. Lovely hotel, very remarkable city. Ancient city. The city is 7,000 years old if it's a day. The Nile is, of course, the great reality of Egypt. And what we hadn't known is that the Egyptians were getting ready for a war, which broke out a few months later when they invaded Israel. They prohibited us from landing anywhere but Cairo, meaning we couldn't stop at Alexandria. Camels, I suspect older ones, on the way to a slaughterhouse, be turned into camel burger. They have appropriate mark on them that they're going to be slaughtered. We're now at the small area called Giza, which is only a few miles outside of Cairo. The city is growing out to it, and hopefully it will not envelop it. This is where the pyramids are. In the background is the Great Pyramid of Cheops, the first of the pharaohs to build a pyramid to himself. This was built in 2600 BC, and is estimated to have taken 30 years to complete. This great pyramid of Cheops, the first known pyramid to be built, faces precisely north. Its height is twice its width, giving a slope of 51.52 degrees, or 51 degrees and 52 minutes slope. Mathematically perfect. The height is 280 cubits in the ancient measure, which is 146.599 meters high. Estimated there are 2.7 billion large stones. Probably cost in those days 830 billion current dollars. The second pyramid, slightly smaller, was built by the pharaoh Cheperon. There is an entrance found to the first pyramid, the Great Pyramid, by grave robbers, and it goes at about a 45 degree slope. Cannot stand up, but you can semi-crawl up the slope, probably 150 feet to inside the pyramid to see where the pharaoh once resided before the grave robbers got there. Here we are inside the tomb room. There's not really a great deal to see. Everything's been taken away. There's been a great suspicion that there are other rooms inside the pyramid or hollowed out areas, and we ran into something very interesting. And this was some American scientists checking gamma rays through the sides of the pyramids to see if they went through any hollow spots. Big organization of scientific equipment with two or three scientists running them. Here's Jack coming out of the passageway. here's the Great Sphinx. Unfortunately, it's weathered very poorly, and at one point was used for cannon practice by an Arab army. It's still awesome. Just below the Sphinx, there's tremendous passageways and infrastructure in front of the Sphinx and a little below. I think it was Bonaparte who said thousands of years looked down upon you when he first arrived in Egypt. Typical camels that are festooned with tassels and rugs that tourists can get on and have their picture taken. Here's a camel jockey bringing along fodder for his livestock. We leased a car to travel this area. We went into American Express to lease the car. We said we wanted an air-conditioned one. It turned out there wasn't an air-conditioned car in Cairo, but they automatically assumed we must be very important people, and they got us King Farouk's limo. So we rode in style. A lot of passengers on one cart. It's a local bus, I think you could call it, with a poor donkey hauling the whole crew. A lot of poles from old palm trees on the ground. An uncovered Sphinx. If you'll notice the stone, it's probably made out of alabaster. Statue of Ramses II. This was uncovered by an elderly American woman some time ago who poked her umbrella and found some stone under it and called a crew together and said, start digging here. They uncovered this gigantic statue and built a building around it. This is Memphis area. An area of gigantic ruins, maybe one of the earliest sites in Egypt, and it is thought to only be 10% excavated. So one can assume that for hundreds of years there will be excavations going on. Again, a local bus. This is the famous Step Pyramid, built thousands of years ago. Really quite a sight. This is inside a tomb, and you're not always able to take pictures inside. They don't allow flash guns in most places. Beautiful illustrations. Beautiful carvings. Infrastructure above a tomb. On a donkey. Here with palm leaves being hauled to God knows where. One of the great mosques in Cairo. Jack and I drinking in a tavern. This is the sunset over Cairo from the Hilton Hotel. Magnificent views in. They're drilling a well at the airport near where our plane was parked, and they're doing it the hard way. No modern equipment at all. One of our ways of communications was through a trailing antenna. They don't have the same communications one has in America, and so we had this World War II type radio aboard. This antenna, when fully deployed, goes out 75 feet. And to get it there, we needed a weight. So we took a little jar, filled it with stones and sand, and deployed it. The weight of the jar pulled the antenna out. And so after we left Cairo, we were able to again communicate on as far away as Athens. This was a beautiful flight to Athens, a place we hadn't planned. What we had planned is going to Alexandria, which we were prohibited from doing, and then landing at Tripoli. But the Israelis had just shot down a Libyan passenger plane, and there were jets all over the area, and discretion was the better part of valor. I didn't want to meet Colonel Gaddafi anyway, so we decided the African part of the trip would end at Cairo and would go on to Athens. Flying over the GNC. We stayed at the King George Hotel in Athens. Early the next morning, I took off, brought all my lenses, and went straight to the Acropolis. and with the wide-angle lenses was able to get some great pictures of the Acropolis, which incidentally one cannot get close to today. Call your attention to the steps, which are probably three times as high as the normal 9-inch steps we take. This was not made for humans, but for gods. The ancient Greeks assumed we're taller than we were. One of the side temples. I believe these statues have been taken down and replaced with imitations since this period. Famous Temple of Zeus, gorgeous Corinthian columns, which 150 years ago were taken down and ground into cement by the Turks. What is left, those they didn't get to. Distant view of the Acropolis, the Parthenon on it. The great hole in the center where it was blown out. Munitions were stored there at one time and went off during the Turkish occupation. Port of Paresis. I believe this was Aristodolonasus's home.
With Africa behind them, the plane was flown to Naples, then arrived in Geneva on March 18, 1973. The two men parted as great friends and shared one of the most exciting adventures of all time.